Hey, Stargazers, welcome back to Skywatch Weekly. Happy summer to everyone, at least those of you here in the Northern Hemisphere. This week, we're going to get our bearings a little bit in the sky. We'll do a quick refresher on the springtime sky, which we've been seeing for a while now, and then get a proper introduction to the summer sky, including a well-known asterism up there, kind of the centerpiece of the sky we'll be looking at for several months. That also includes a couple of bright planets as well, so let's dive right in. We're going to begin tonight looking west, just about 2 hours past sunset. Now, that's about 10:30 here in Chicago, so you don't have to worry too much about waiting up till then to see a lot of this. If you're out at about 9 p.m., maybe a little bit after that, you should have a great view of this, just in a slightly brighter sky. Probably the first thing you'll notice looking west tonight is the beautiful thin crescent moon. It's on its way to a first quarter moon coming up on the night of Saturday and into Sunday evening as well. It'll be half lit at that point, but right now, beautiful thin crescent, a great chance to get out there and check it out with binoculars or a telescope. So here we have Regulus, the brightest star in the sickle of Leo the Lion. This is marking the head and the mane, and the rest of the body and tail are shown by this stick figure here. Leo is a true springtime constellation. It's setting in the earlier part of the evening as we get into the summer. Now, you'll still be able to see it in late July after sunset, but it will be lower and lower until eventually it'll be blocked by the sun in August. Up above Leo and to the right, so northwest of it, is the Big Dipper. We had talked about the circumpolar stars in our video on May 6th, but as a refresher, you can use the Big Dipper to find things in the sky. Now, one of the things we hadn't mentioned is Leo. If you imagine poking a hole in the bottom of the bowl of the dipper, the water will drip down onto the back of Leo. You can also use the handle of the dipper to find two other bright spring stars. Just following that shape of the arc of the handle, you can arc to Arcturus, and then speed down to Spica, or some people say drive a spike to Spica. Arcturus is part of the constellation called Boötes the Herdsman, and Spica is the brightest star in the zodiac sign of Virgo the Maiden. All right, so everything we just saw is on the western half of the sky by about an hour past sunset this time of the year. So as the Earth spins and things rise in the east and set in the west, this part of the sky will be the first to go as we get later in the night and also later in the summer. Now, what's rising in the evening is what'll be with us through the summer, and the centerpiece of that is this triangle of stars called the Summer Triangle. By about 10 p.m., this will be about a third of the way up in the eastern sky. We've mentioned this asterism, this pattern of stars, several times in these videos, but let's really dive in. The triangle straddles the Milky Way, this hazy band of stars across the sky that has a pretty incredible appearance in the summertime. If you're able to get to a dark sky on a moonless night this summer, it's well worth the effort, a breathtaking view of our home galaxy. Well, the Summer Triangle is made up of three stars, each one part of a different constellation. We've got Deneb, Vega, and Altair. Altair is part of the constellation Aquila the Eagle, which isn't all that bright, but Altair certainly catches the eye. We have Vega, part of Lyra the Harp, which we talked about quite a bit in our double star episode on June 10th. The star Epsilon Lyrae is a famous double star, so check out that June 10th episode to learn more. In the constellation of Lyra is a very well-known deep sky object known as the Ring Nebula. Now, this is not a naked eye object, but if you do have a small telescope and want to take a look, it's right in between these two stars at the end of the parallelogram. This ring is visible through small telescopes as a fairly dim, smoky ring. But with larger telescopes, a lot more detail becomes apparent. Now, let's take a flight to the nebula and see what we're looking at. The Ring Nebula is about 2,000 light years away, so this is way beyond a lot of the stars we can see in the sky, and well beyond where any of our spacecraft have ever gone. But we can visualize the structure of this nebula based on observations we've made from Earth. So the ring is really a shell of material that was ejected from a star much like our Sun. As Sun-like stars age, they shed their outer atmosphere until all that's left of the star is the exposed core, a white dwarf star. This shell of material, what used to be the outer atmosphere of the star, is now about 2 or 3 light years across. So that would stretch from our Sun almost to the closest star. It's a huge distance. Well, our third star in the triangle, and the dimmest of the three, is Deneb, the tail of Cygnus, the swan. The name Deneb is of Arabic origin and literally means tail. There are several other tail stars in the sky, including Denebola, the tail of Leo the lion. Another interesting star in the swan is the head of the swan, a star called Albireo. This is another classic double star, this one with a beautiful color difference. Just with your eyes, it looks like one point of light, but with a telescope, you can see two stars. One is a lovely golden-orange color, and the other's a nice greenish-blue. Now, whether this is a true double star system is currently unknown, but even if it is just a chance alignment, it's still a beautiful view. Well, that covers the brighter stars in the summer triangle, but there are a few dimmer ones worth looking for. Cutting across the point of the triangle is the constellation Sagitta, the arrow. It's fairly dim, but a fun little challenge. And parallel to it is the constellation of Vulpecula, the fox. This one is truly dim and hard to see, but it contains a neat little grouping of stars called Brocky's cluster. Most people, though, know it as the coat hanger. Through binoculars, it's easy to see why. You can find it by scanning this part of the sky between Vega and Altair with your binoculars. Our third dim constellation around the triangle is my personal favorite, a dolphin. Delphinus is marked by this small diamond of stars marking the head and then a trailing arc of stars that make up the tail. I can't say why, but I just love this constellation. It's dim enough for a challenge, but unmistakable once you see it. So that makes it perfect for our weekly challenge. Get out there, look for Delphinus the dolphin in your sky. From darker skies, easily seen with the naked eye. From a place like Chicago, you might need some binoculars to help you out. Well, if you imagine the summer triangle as sort of an arrowhead, it's pointing right now at two very bright points of light down in the southeast. We're going to cover these two in depth in a few weeks, but for now, give them a look if you're out past about 10 p.m. when they rise. This is Jupiter and Saturn. We've been talking about them in the context of the morning sky for a couple of months now, but here they are, rising earlier and earlier every night, and starting to make a great appearance this summer. Well, they're in another interesting part of the summertime sky, down here in the south. That includes Antares, the heart of Scorpius the Scorpion, and this teapot shape, that's part of Sagittarius the Archer. Well, I promise you, we're going to dig into this part of the sky as well over the next few weeks. But for now, get out there and catch those planets, Jupiter and Saturn. They are super bright, easily seen just with your eyes, even through tremendous light pollution. So that's what we've got for you this week. Plenty to look forward to over the summer, and we'll be covering it all here on Skywatch Weekly. Let us know in the comments what you think, and also if there's anything else you'd like us to cover, topics in space that you're curious about. We're always happy to dig into those a little bit. Also, don't forget to subscribe and follow the Adler Planetarium on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. Thanks so much, and we'll see you again soon.